having me here, and I'm excited to talk to everybody about SPACs. My name is George Arison, and I'm the co-founder and co-CEO of Shift. We are a public company trading on NASDAQ. We went public this fall in October using a merger with a SPAC to do it. We were one of the first companies in technology and maybe the first one in Silicon Valley this past year to go through a SPAC transaction. So it was an exciting kind of 6 months for us when we had a ton to do to get the deal done. So I was asked to talk about what does one need to know to get a SPAC transaction done and how would one go about doing it. So excited to talk about that. And this is the third time I've had a chance to speak at Startup Grind. The last couple of times I spoke at regional conferences and really enjoyed those conversations. Obviously can't wait to be able to do it live again, but for now we'll settle for the virtual event. There are some slides that I think we're gonna be looking at while I speak, so perhaps we can put up the presentation and we can go from there. So we could jump to the next slide a little bit first on what is a SPAC. SPACs are, and if you could go to the next page as well, please. So SPACs are translated as special purpose acquisition companies. These are blank check companies that raise money from investors. They don't actually have an operating business. And their sole purpose is to merge with a private company and through that merger for the private company to become public. All the money that's raised in a SPAC transaction when it goes public sits in a trust. It can be touched until the merger is completed. And then the post-merger, the new company has the opportunity to use that money to operate its business. SPACs have existed for a long time. They've been around for decades, but over the last 12 to 24 months, they've become a lot more popular. There's really kind of five big benefits of a SPAC that exist. And I think it's worth kind of talking through those for a minute. The first four really are benefits to the company that is going public through a SPAC, i.e. the private company. Number one, it allows the company to time the market really well. If the market is doing great, that's a good time to do an IPO, but if you've not planned all the steps for an IPO, you can't really make an IPO happen. And so SPAC allows you to kind of time the market really well. And number two, it's a lot faster. You can get a SPAC done in 4 to 6 months, whereas getting a normal IPO done usually takes about 18 to 24 months. So the time period is cut dramatically. Number three, it allows you to raise a lot more money than a traditional IPO because of how the underwriting processes work with banks. And number four, in a SPAC transaction, you're able to talk about the future and what might happen with the business and the money you raise once the transaction happens. And that's generally not permitted in an IPO sense. So IPOs are very past looking, whereas SPAC transactions are forward looking, which for a lot of companies is a lot better. And then the fifth reason why SPACs are interesting is more focused around benefits to the market participants, meaning investors in the public market. What we've seen in the United States and frankly around the world is that over the last decade, a lot more companies have stayed private for a very long time, raising gobs and gobs of money as private businesses, which is fine, but it really keeps the public market participants who don't invest in private companies from being able to accrue any of the benefits of the value creation that happens when companies are growing quickly, which obviously is not great for all the public market participants, especially the smaller, what is otherwise known as the retail investors. The reality is that historically before, companies would go public when they were worth a lot less money, and then they would accrue a ton of growth as public companies. Example, Salesforce and Zillow, when they went public, over 10 years ago, went public for less than $1 billion. And now obviously those companies are worth many orders of magnitude more than that. And so if folks invested in the IPO or soon thereafter, the value creation accrued to those shareholders. And when companies wait to go public until they're worth a lot more and kind of have finished up their growth, the value creation is a lot more limited. That's obviously unfortunate. There's a lot of reasons why that's happened. But what SPACs have allowed folks to do is to have companies go public sooner, allowing public market participants to invest in those companies and then have an opportunity for that value creation that will happen while those companies grow. So that's actually a really big plus. I call it the democratization of investing in more venture style companies, and that's really beneficial. So now with that kind of context, let's jump to sort of what are the things that CEOs and executive teams at companies need to know if they consider a SPAC transaction. So let's jump to the next slide, please. So first, I think it's really important to become a SPAC expert. SPACs are a fairly complex financial instrument, much more so than a typical IPO. There's a lot of kind of unique things you need to be aware of as you do that transaction. And so it's really important for the leadership team at a company and the board to become intimately familiar with a SPAC. Obviously, they're a lot less kind of complex in terms of understanding today than they were even 12 months ago when far fewer companies were considering this option. But there's still a lot of things that one needs to know. And so I would strongly advise folks to kind of really get a chance to understand how these transactions work and what to be aware of. When I was doing diligence on SPACs, I spoke to two partners at very, very large and very prominent private equity shops. And both of them had taken companies through a SPAC transaction. And both of them independently said something like this, where like, I thought I was really good at financial engineering and knew what I was doing. And then I got into the SPAC transaction and turns out I didn't know what I was doing. And so when I heard that from them, it was a really kind of wake up call for me as far as what we need to be aware of. Because if folks at these really top private equity shops are not confident about their knowledge, then it's even more of an issue for founders and CEOs of more product-driven technology companies like me or others that operate in the space that I operate in. Next slide. So point number two is really kind of be aware of your blind spots and hire the right folks around you as quickly as possible. In technology companies and product-driven companies, we tend to really undervalue the importance of legal, the importance of finance and bankers. If you were to go through a SPAC transaction, those folks are going to become really, really instrumental for your success. So getting the right advisors around you, both in-house and externally, is really critical. We relied on our lawyers in a massive way. We relied on our bankers in a massive way. They're super critical to this transaction. And so getting the right people around you is really important. From the point of view of hiring kind of bankers or lawyers, my recommendation is to always focus on people who've had SPAC experience, who've taken companies through these types of transactions. And that's something very different than, say, someone having a vertical knowledge of your particular space. Next slide. So point number three is around how many SPACs you talk to. This is really important. I think it's always been really important, but it's even more so today. Given that we've seen a massive proliferation of SPACs out there. So when we were doing our deal, there were about 40 to 50 active SPACs looking for companies to merge with. Today, they're close to 300, I believe, maybe even more. It's kind of hard to keep up given how many are being issued on a daily basis. And so you don't want to kind of go on an overkill, with everybody, because that'll be a waste of your time. But it's really important to kind of cast a broad net and talk to a broad number of folks out there, because there are fundamental differences. SPACs have different types of terms in them when they went public. They have different types of backers as investors, and expectations might be different across different backers. And so that's a kind of important consideration to make as you talk to folks. And then it's also really important to understand kind of who are the folks involved with the SPAC itself. I think given how many SPACs have been issued over the last 12 months or so, and really, frankly, not even 12 months, more like 9 months, a lot of the teams that have raised SPAC capital and have kind of SPACs out there looking for companies to merge with are generally very nascent in the SPAC ecosystem. They've not taken companies through a SPAC transaction on either side of the table, have not been either executives of companies that have done a SPAC or have not done a SPAC before and kind of merge with that company. And so, most of the time they actually don't frankly know what they are doing. And so really, I think important as you kind of vet which SPACs to talk to see if they have people involved that actually have been through these types of transactions. And so whether it's folks on the board or folks on the management team of the SPAC, kind of vetting for that in-house knowledge of having done a deal like this, I think is super critical and can really overestimate how important that will be for your consideration set. And I think that once you kind of take that view towards the 300 SPACs that are out there now looking for mergers, a bunch of them will drop out because most of them don't have that type of expertise and the type of in-house knowledge of having gone through a transaction like this. Why does this matter? The reason is that there's going to be things that pop up that is really hard to predict, where knowledge and experience will really, really matter in a critical way and could save time and or avoid pitfalls that could become problematic. That's the reality, and you can't predict what all those are going to be. And so having experience of them going through that is really critical. And then the second consideration set as you meet with SPACs, I think, has to do with size. What's happened over the last, 9 months is that everyone's been raising bigger and bigger SPACs. That's been especially true among repeat SPAC issuers, like kind of the really strong brand names that are out there that have done many SPACs. They've generally been raising larger and larger SPACs. Of course, the rationale for why makes sense from the economics standpoint. Bigger the SPAC, the more financially beneficial it is for the founding team. And so they want to raise bigger SPACs, but that's not always ideal from the company perspective. And so as a company, you want to think about what's the right size for you. Generally speaking, you want to have at least a 4x enterprise value to your company versus the SPAC size. So if you're talking to a $250 million SPAC, you want the enterprise value of your company to be at least $1 billion, ideally more. And so from that perspective, a lot of the companies that are looking at SPACs and for whom SPAC is a great pathway to being public, need SPACs on the smaller side, kind of below the $300 million range. But a lot of the SPACs that are being raised are over $300 million. And so there's a little bit of a misalignment between SPACs that are being raised versus what size SPACs companies need. Smaller SPACs are a lot less dilutive. They come with less warrants. They come with less sponsor shares. And so they're very advantageous. And there's other kind of advantages during the de-SPAC, meaning merger process of small SPACs. And so that's something to keep in mind. It might sound counterintuitive that smaller is better, but it generally is. When you do a SPAC, you also raise what's called a PIPE, which is a separate transaction kind of piece that happens along the way where you tell your story to investors privately as if you were doing a private round prior to the public announcement and raise capital or get capital commitments from them. That money comes into the deal as well alongside the money that's sitting inside the trust. And so if you want to raise a lot more money that's inside the SPAC itself, you can always do a larger PIPE. And that's very doable. And if your business is good, that'll work quite well. The bigger the PIPE, frankly, the cheaper the capital, because it doesn't come with warrants that were issued when the SPAC raised its IPO. And so you could easily do, say, a $200 million SPAC and raise $400 million in a PIPE. There's nothing that kind of stands in the way of that. And so smaller SPACs are generally better, and being careful in how you pick those is really important. So I think vetting for the right team and vetting for the right size is something that folks should keep in mind as they consider this process. And so then jumping to the next page, which is the last point here, is around how you behave as a public company. So being a public company is fundamentally very different than being a private company. Half a year, if not longer, you're in a quiet period as a public company and as a public company executive. So you can't really talk about the business and how the business is performing because you're not allowed to do that during the quiet period. And so what you say and how you say it becomes really crucial. And managing for that is its own kind of special skill set that folks develop over time. So there's a lot that you need to keep in mind in terms of company culture and your own operations as an executive at a public company that's really different from what you might be used to as a private company leader, whether it's CEO or something else. It is an adjustment, and it's a pretty substantial adjustment. So sooner you start behaving that way, the better off it is for you. It's not easy. I've been a private, or before our transaction, I was a private company CEO for a long time. This is the second time I had started a company. So I've been kind of as a founder at a private company for a long, long time and have had a lot of experience with that. it is a really big adjustment towards becoming a public company. And so the sooner you kind of start on that process, I think the better off you are. And part of that involves hiring the right people, right? Hiring the right senior leaders in your company to help you along the way. So that's pretty much it. Thank you very much and appreciate everyone taking the time.